Great. We'll talk about Couchbase a little bit, a few slides, kind of give you a background. We'll talk about NoSQL. NoSQL versus SQL, the land structure, queries, and query results. So we'll go advanced. We'll talk about some advanced features of indexing, and how queries work. And we'll talk about some of the tools available to you from a developer perspective. And also some of our ecosystem support we have with third parties and other connectors, integration with their other products. So Couchbase Server, it's a high throughput, low latency, NoSQL distributed database. It's a built-in distributed cache. When you do a read, when you do a write, you're going to go directly to memory. When you do a read, you're going to go directly to memory. When you do a write, you go to memory, and eventually it's going to be persistent as disk. But what that means is you can read what you've written immediately. Growth of commodity hardware, a distributed shared method architecture, support of all local peers, offer strong consistency and elastic scalability. We also offer Couchbase Server replicas as well. This is a single node in Couchbase. So single node in Couchbase has three main components: the cluster manager, the managed cache, and storage of software persistence. Every node in Couchbase is here. In Couchbase 4.0, we introduced a new feature called services. We have a JS service, an indexing service, and a query service. And what that allows you to do is study your cluster not only horizontally, but vertically as well if you need to. So we call it multi-dimensional scale, or DS. So we took a step back and looked at the cluster overall and how the cluster overall. This is what you see. At the top, it's your application tier, and it's a library with client libraries. These are called smart clients. You also see the cluster. The cluster itself, like I said, the three main components, the cluster manager, the managed cache, and the storage engine are the same across in every node. The only thing that differs are the services that you install and configure on each node. So in this case, we have a six-node cluster. We have two nodes we dedicated for our data service, so that's new cache operations, git, set, etc. Very fast, low latency key rewrites. We also have indexing server. In this case, I have two nodes dedicated indexing server. Things I might scale up a bit, maybe bump up the CPU a bit. And we also have two nodes dedicated to the query service. The query service is what pops in the legal statements that you execute. So, storing data in Couchbase. So, all data in Couchbase is stored in key value pair. So, in general, our bread and butter is as a key value store. That's what we are. That's what Couchbase is, right? You have a document or a blob, you want to store it in a database, you store it with the primary key. A document itself, or the value of that document can either be a JSON object or it can be a binary blob. The server itself will define decide how to actually store it. So for example, if you store a string, it's an invalid JSON string, then it'll store it as a binary blob. If you store a string and it's actually a JSON, it will be stored as a JSON document. If you store a string, if you store another, you say an integer, you have to store an integer as a JSON object as well. And that's just a JSON encoder. And it's handled by the SDKs. Copies of our arbitrary length and depth. The maximum size we have right now is 20 megabytes. Documents contain scalers, other objects, arrays, and collections. Each document has its own quite scalar. What's important about that is you can evolve, your schema can evolve over time. And what I mean by that is when you first start developing an application, you first start developing maybe a data point you want to store, right? You're not sure exactly what you're going to store. it may take trial and error to actually build up so you have something that's a minimal viable product that you can maybe show your colleagues and say, look, you want to do well with this. It's very important. We do it very quickly. You can contrast that with like a relational database where you have a table-oriented architecture where you have tables with columns and then you have other tables that contain metadata. The metadata in those columns describes the table structure that you have defined in your schema. Making a change is relatively difficult, right? You have to go in, so you can change that metadata, and metadata doesn't persist it out. If you have applications that depend on that table structure, then you have to go and update the removing a column is more difficult. It's more difficult. So introducing Nickel. So what is Nickel? So Nickel takes the expressive power of SQL. So everyone here, I'm sure everyone here has used SQL before. Everyone, right? So everyone knows SQL, it's very familiar, it's very expressive, it's very powerful. It combines that with a rich data store. JSON is a rich data store, right? So your JSON objects can model your real world much more effectively than your relational database. You could argue. It also combines relational algebra. The relational algebra allows you to do things you can't do with SQL. Things like create a nested document out of a flattened document, or create a flattened document in reverse out of a nested document. What that makes is our SQL correlated for rich data. Some of the key differences. So I kind of already talked about this, but right, the data model. So we have the static data model that you define up front in your relational database, right? Versus this fluid data model that you build up over time. You build up through trial and error, through maybe through learning a bit about your problem domain that you're trying to solve. Another difference is data is constrained to a key space. So data in a relational database is stored in a container, right? And with Nickel, a key space, you have this concept of a key space. A key space is a bucket in Couchbase. All your documents can fit within a single, all your documents, whether or not they are the same documents or not, whether they're the same shape or form, just store in the same bucket. That makes doing projections even more difficult, right? Maybe you have missing fields, maybe you have fields that may have a value, may not have a value. Well, that's all possible with JSON, obviously you need a language that can support these scenarios. You also want the language that can support reshaping your data. Some of the other differences, right? It's a table versus key space. So when you do a select all in SQL, right? You do a select all from a table. And with Nickel, you do a select all from key space. You get every single, you go across your entire key space. So that's like a database going across your entire schema. Any ways of constraining the size of the data that you're going to query when you do a select. It also has new operators, such as the dot operator. You're familiar with auditory programming, well, all of it now, right? The dot operator allows you to access nested objects. You also have brackets that are for arrays or reflections. And you have special functions that can work with arrays and reflections. So like I said, you have special keywords for working with data that's missing or is null. If you're writing a JSON document, the value can exist, did not exist, or it can be null. They're all different. They're all very different. So what does language structure look like? So language structure is broken down into three main components. You have statements, you have expressions, and you have comments. Statements are data definition language. You have a way of creating indexes. You have data manipulation language. Way of creating documents. New documents you want to store in your database. And maybe if you want to update a document, there are ways of updating a document to take statements. These are insert, update, replace, etc. That's like query statements. Query is the main way of pulling data out of your key space. We also have expressions. Expressions are JSON expressions. So this allows you to go deep within a document to pull out nested data. Of course, comments. Comments are just comments, right? Queries and results. So when you submit a statement, statement. You can you have, so you can select a statement, you have nested subquery, just like in SQL. You query across multiple documents and joins. So if you have multiple documents, then maybe you have embedded keys within one document that refer to another document, you can do a join of those two and combine those to create a projection as a combination. There's some special operators and functions allowing you to navigate through arrays and deal with arrays. Additionally, just like in SQL, you have merge clause for predicates. You also have group by, order by, and then an offset. SQL provides paths to support nested data. And like I said, these paths are just arrays, these paths are used to get up these arrays and all the data to get the attributes. So for example, the bottom here, I have a last line, orders, bracket, zero, bracket, dot product ID. So orders is an array, and I'm getting the first element of that array, and then I'm pulling out product_ID. Product_ID is likely a key from a referred object, or referred document. So what does the NQL statement look like? Well, that's exciting, right? How many people have seen a statement before? Everyone? That's exciting, right? But it is different. The reason why it is different is because of two things. First of all, instead of being a table here, the front key is pointing at, it's pointing at a key space. This key space is the beer sample database that comes pre-configured or comes with Couchbase server. It also has is not missing, which is something, actually maybe in some SQL, depending on the rest of the SQL implementation, may be there or may not be there. But in this case, what it's saying is, hey, query ID is missing, don't return that document, and limit it to two. Query results. So with a relational database with SQL, right, you issue a SQL command, and back you can return a results that arose. When you do an execute statement with NQL, you get back a JSON document. The JSON document has additional metadata nested or embedded within it. Request ID, the signature, status, and the metrics. Important is the status. The status can tell you whether or not the statement succeeded or not. If it's true, then it succeeded. If it's false, it didn't. If it's false, you're going to have another collection of data in the error method, in the errors array. That error array is going to give you hints as to what actually failed. It makes it very easy to debug your queries as you're working through it. There's also metrics that are in there as well. You can see inside how performant the query was. So query results. Here's an example of query results. Request ID pop to get UID. And the signature is used by the query engine itself, and here's the results. The results, even though they're in a row-like structure, they can be nested data, they can be documents themselves. And again, there's the status, in this case it's success, the probability value is actually successful or failure. And then the metrics. The metrics also return back the result count and then the size of the actual result size. It also supports system information. So NQL has a system catalog that stores metadata. And this metadata is queryable. The system catalog is called system, go figure. Each artifact in it has a key space. And then a logical hierarchy. A logical hierarchy starts with data source, which is a cluster. A namespace, which is a unit of tenancy and authentication. And then a key space, which is a bucket in the Couchbase. The bucket is really analogous to a database in a relational database. It also contains information about indexes and duals. Duals allow you to evaluate expressions like SQL5 and SQL11. All these namespaces are key spaces are queried. So here's some of the things that come from SQL, which looks really very familiar to you. The general select for projections. Where, join, group by, order by, limit, union, intersect. Join is a little different though. Join, it's not quite the same. The syntax is a little different than a traditional database. And that's because when you store data, when you store a document in Couchbase, it actually stores the document itself, the content, and then it stores the metadata about that document. The metadata about that document is the keys, the time to live, the cal value, the authentication currency, and some additional data. In order to do your join, you need to use a special keyword, and that is the on keys keyword. In this example, we're pulling out the brewery name, as brewery name is an alias, and beer, from your sample beer, and we're going to join, self-join back on that beer, based on the brewery ID of beer. So basically, for everything in listable brewery, you're going to get back a list of beers associated with that brewery. Some of the things for JSON, specifically for JSON, nest, unnest, use keys and objects. Nest and unnest are where it really deviates from the traditional SQL, and that you can take a flat document and turn it into a nested document. Conversely, you use unnest to do the reverse, to create a flattened document, a flattened row out of a nested document. A special kind of join, that's a special kind of join. Example, select brewery and beer from beer sample, brewery, use keys, Google Modelo, nest, beer on keys, brewery, beer, ID. So what this is going to do is actually create a nested document out of all of the beer IDs, sorry, out of the brewery name of beers that are associated with Google Modelo. Unnest is another special type of join. Like I said, it's a clock structure. This is the syntax. Select all from beer sample with B. Use keys. Use keys is a special keyword that's actually going to look at the primary keys in the metadata of that bucket. And it's going to unnest the address of